journey that we call Holy Week that leads us to the cross or to the empty grave. If you're a visitor to the house, we especially welcome you. If you would like to know more about our faith family, we invite you to raise your hand gently and we will gently give you more information so that you may better understand who we are. So are there any visitors to the house on this day? Ah, okay, well, down here, as you will. Welcome, we welcome you in the name of the Christ. Hope that this encourages your life and faith. A couple of announcements, we'll be on our way. One is the only sign up out there at the moment is the sign up for Easter brunch, which, believe it or not, is next Sunday. So that's always a festive occasion for us, a time of great fellowship and great food. If you're planning to attend, please sign up so the Board of Fellowship knows how many people to prepare for it. We would like to think that we're like Jesus, you know, with 5 loaves and 2 fishes, but we don't have that kind of power, so we need to know ahead of time who's coming. Otherwise, this coming week, we have services both on Maundy Thursday and on Good Friday. Both of those services are at noon. There's no luncheon afterwards and no service in the evening. This works best for us at this point. And we are delighted today to be able to welcome some new members to this faith family. So that having been said, we listen to the opening music.
Thank you.
invite our new members down to the front, if you would be so kind. This doesn't hurt, honestly. I was hoping Warren would still be here too, but he's been received once, he's in. Okay. Anyway, we praise you, O God, for this day and for these new people and brothers and sisters who come to us. So I ask you now to profess your faith in Christ Jesus, to reject sin, to confess the faith of the church. Do you believe in God the Father Almighty, the creator of heaven and earth? If so, answer, I do. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, was buried, who descended to the dead, who on the third day rose again, ascending into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and who will come again to judge the living and the dead? If this is your belief, then please answer, I do so believe. Do you also believe in God, the Holy Spirit, and the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sin, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting? If this is your belief, then please answer, I do so believe. My brothers and sisters, you have made public profession of your faith. I now ask, do you intend to continue in the covenant God made with you in holy baptism, to live among God's faithful people, to hear the word of God and share in the Lord's Supper, to proclaim the good news of God in Christ through word and deed, to serve all people following the example of Jesus, and to strive for justice and peace in all the earth? If so, answer, I do, and I ask God to help and guide me.
I do.
Please turn and face the faith family. Now, for those who are already in the family, you have heard the promises of these new brothers and sisters. I now ask, do you promise to support and enthusiastically encourage these brothers and sisters and pray for them in their life in Christ and to share this journey of ministry with them? Please answer, we do, and we ask God to help and guide us.
We do.
Let us then pray. We praise you, O God, for the gift of this day, this Palm Sunday, the beginning of this journey to the cross and to the grave. We are so grateful and thankful for these who are willing to walk with us in this journey and the journey of ministry that you now set before us. We ask your blessing upon them and upon us as we seek to incarnate the love that you made real for us. Bless us, Lord, as we seek these new brothers and sisters as partners in the faith. Amen.
Amen.
And let the people of God say. And having been watched over carefully by the president of the congregation and the head elder, you are now in. Please go back to your seat and return. Go in peace and serve the Lord. And for all of you, I invite you, if you are able, to rise as we begin our praise to a very gracious God. As always, we make our strong beginning. In the name of God the Father, and of God the Son, and of God the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
And we join together.
Holy Christ, whose journey among us was shaped in humility, help us to walk as you did, serving others more than self, giving out more than taking in, so that the world might be drawn to your embracing love. Amen.
Please remain standing for the singing of the psalms.
Thank you.
invite you to join with me in the words of confession. Holy God,
we sing Hosanna with our lips, but still question in our mind. Our faith is not nearly as strong as we pretend. Our doubts far more than we can admit. We hesitate in following you. Our words and actions, less than humble or graceful, have mercy on us.
Let us take a moment of silence to reflect on how we've been living our life in these last several days. Fellow redeemed, it was for our weakness that Christ became strong, walking the way of the cross so that God's mercy overshadows our fault. Through him, we are united with God. So hear again God's gracious word. You are in Christ truly forgiven and truly free. Rejoice. May be seated for the reading of the lessons. Lessons assigned to be read on this Palm Sunday take us to the Old Testament and to the prophecy of Isaiah. It's in Isaiah chapter 50. I'd like you to reflect as you listen to these words being read. Envision Jesus maybe reciting them to himself as he's being led to the cross on Good Friday, a servant who gave his life for all. Isaiah 50, beginning at verse 4.
The sovereign Lord has given me a well-instructed tongue to know the word that sustains the weary. He wakens me morning by morning, wakens my ear to listen like being one instructed. The sovereign Lord has opened my ears. I have not been rebellious. I have not turned away. I offered my back to those who beat me, my cheeks to those who pulled out my beard. I did not hide my voice from mocking and spitting. Because the sovereign Lord helps me, I will not be disgraced. Therefore, have I set my face like flint. I know I will not be put to shame. He will vindicate me, vindicates me as near. Who then will bring charges against me? Let us face each other. Who is my accuser? Let him comfort me. It is a sovereign Lord who helps me, who will redeem me. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The New Testament reading is from the pen of St. Paul as he writes to the small house church in first century Philippi and trying to help them again to begin to understand the radical difference in Christianity and what it actually calls us to do and to be. What is the implication, if you will, of the Palm Sunday that we celebrate today? In turn, it comes down, of course, to servanthood. Jesus, who became servant for us, taking the journey from exaltation to the cross. Let us listen to these words from Philippians 2 and take them to heart.
In your relationship with one another, have the same mindset as Jesus Christ, who being in very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used for his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man. He humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on the cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name. That is the name Jesus, every knee shall bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, who is the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The word of the Holy Gospel is given to us from the witness of St. Mark, the 11th chapter, beginning at the first verse. This is the Markan account of the entry into Jerusalem. As they approached Jerusalem and came to Bethphage and Bethany at the Mount of Olives, Jesus sent two of his disciples. Say to them, go to the village ahead of you, and just as you enter it, you will find a colt tied there, which no one has ever ridden. Untie it, bring it here. If anyone asks you, why are you doing this? Say, the Lord needs it, and we'll send it back here shortly. So they went and found a colt outside in the street, tied at a doorway. And as they untied it, some people standing there asked, what are you doing untying that colt? They answered as Jesus had told them to, and the people let them go. And when they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the fields. And those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. Hosanna in the highest heaven. Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into the temple courts. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
With heart and voice, we affirm our faith in this Christ in the words of the creedal statement. I believe
in one God, united on high, ruler of the heavens and the earth, full of grace and mercy. I believe in the Father, who has created me and all that exists. I believe in the Son, who has redeemed me by his death and resurrection. By my baptism into his name, I am saved from sin, death, and the power of the devil. He, both God and man, my Lord Jesus Christ, is now seated at the right hand of the Father. I believe in the Holy Spirit, who daily sanctifies me.
He dresses me and guides me
as I live my life in the body of Christ, the one true holy apostolic church. On the last day, he will gather me and all believers, even raising them from the dead, into heaven, where I will live in holiness and blessedness forever. Amen.
May be seated for the singing of the hymn. God's grace, God's mercy, and God's kind of peace rest deep in your hearts, deep in your minds, this day and always, because of our Lord Jesus Christ. The text is the gospel lesson for Palm Sunday, just read a few moments ago. So far, the text. Have you ever been at a parade? Yes, you have. Parades are always meant to be impressive and kind of exciting, things to catch the eye and sort of to catch the mind and the heart. Parades are designed to be a kind of feel-good experience all the way around, both for those who are in the parade and those who are politely watching it. The parade described in our text, however, was certainly a far different version. No marching bands, one participant riding on the back of a barred donkey. Some rabid fans shouting things out and putting palm branches on the road in front of the donkey. But for the whole crowd sort of watching this from a very polite distance, this was indeed a curious spectacle. And those who were there as tourists for the Passover festival were quickly scanning the this week's events in Jerusalem. And this one was not listed. They didn't know quite what to make of this. The destination for this little parade was the East Gate of Jerusalem. It was essentially the back door to the city. And of the 200,000 or more that crowded the streets of Jerusalem during the festival of Passover, only the religious authorities were paying any serious attention to this parade. If going to church was part of your childhood, on Sunday, you know, it's an important day. And you've been at this for a while, there's probably lots of memories that come flooding back to your mind. Maybe you were confirmed on Palm Sunday. Maybe you took communion for the first time on Palm Sunday. Or maybe you recall that as a child, you were given one of those long palm fronds that we just waved in the air. And of course, being kids, we immediately used them to hit each other. But the whole atmosphere was kind of upbeat, the hymns were kind of pleasant, people seemed to be in a good mood, and it was an altogether fine day. It was like being at a parade. It takes you a while, perhaps a lifetime, to begin to understand that behind all of those pleasant memories of Palm Sunday is the call to model your life after Jesus. You have that servanthood, that humility, that grace, as if you were riding on a donkey coming into the back door of Jerusalem. As Paul said it in the epistle lesson this morning, have this mindset among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus. It's a mindset that is never seeking attention for self, but rather spending our time and energy in serving other people in Christ's name and with his love. That's important to remember, because one of the things that historians have learned since the first Palm Sunday is that there was actually another parade coming into the city on the same day. It's every year on the first Sunday of the Passover festival week, well, the Roman governor Pilate would make his entrance. He didn't spend much time in Jerusalem. He really hated his assignment. He spent his time at Caesarea, 60 miles up the road, a pleasant seaside resort. But he had to come into Jerusalem once a year. And envision, if you will, before Pilate walking in are legions of Roman soldiers and others on horseback, all with their bright red colors, and their shields and their swords glistening in the morning sun. And finally followed by Pilate riding in a regal chariot so that everyone would take notice. He came in that front door so that nobody could miss him. It was a parade that was meant to impress, but also meant to gently remind everyone that Rome was in charge. Lest any kind of Passover zeal among Passover tourists or the residents of Jerusalem spill over into some sort of fomenting rebellion against Rome. Two different parades. One to impress, one to serve. And since most of the 200,000 people or more who were in the city had no idea who Jesus was, residents or tourists, it's a safe bet that far more people were watching the parade at the front door of the city where Pilate came in, rather than Jesus' entry at the back door. But of course, the human eye and the human heart has always been caught by displays of power. Even in our own time, we pay attention to people who have power. Whether it's the arena of sports or politics or business or anything else you can imagine, those are the people who are always put before us as success. We make fun of them, we criticize them, but we pay attention to what they do and what they say. Because if truth be told, there's a little piece of us that is kind of envious. If we think about it hard enough, we would like to have a little bit more control over people and things that are going on in our life. Things that we can't change and people that we can't fix. Because if we had power, well, that would equate with control. And we continue to insist on living with the illusion. When you have control, life is good. The problem with power and control is that once you get it, you have to fight to keep it. Like the game we used to play as kids called King of the Mountain. Eventually, if you're on the top, someone or something is going to overwhelm your power and your control, and you will be left empty again. How ironic it is that the human heart is far more satisfied when we let go of control. When we let go of trying to be in power. The human heart is far more satisfied when we spend our time and energy using who and what God has made us to be, serving others who are in need. Little ways, small ways. When we're able to help others, when we're able to serve in love, well, then it is that we sleep well at night. So 2 weeks ago, I was here on a Saturday morning early, and I happened to glance through the door of the fellowship hall and realized there were probably 100 people here for the AA meeting. They've been meeting here for years. I stayed out here politely, but when they were done, when they disbanded, I quietly walked in and went into the kitchen just to get a cup of coffee. And one of the attendees at the meeting saw my collar. She began to praise LCOS for your gracious hospitality, because they've been meeting here a long time and you've never questioned them. Well, I listened to what she had to say and I responded quietly, "Well, we're glad to help. I think it's what Jesus had in mind." She turned and looked at me and smiled and said, "Not everyone in this community thinks like you do." And she quietly walked away. And I stood there for a moment, not quite sure what to say. And I really wanted to tell her, "I don't know how else to think. I don't think this congregation knows how else to think. This is what faith calls us to do and to be. And if we are doing this, then perhaps we need to take a harder look at who we are. If it isn't about servanthood, I don't think it's what Jesus had in mind." And what drives us to this posture, to this mindset that Paul talks about, is that we worship the God of the back door. The people who come to the front door of your life are always the ones who are in authority. They're in control. They have power. They want you to notice. They want you to affirm them. They want you to obey them. The people we know and love come to the back door of our life, which is where the heart is, more humbly and gracefully than the others. How interesting to think. And when our God decided to come among us, God came in the back door. The back door of Bethlehem. The back door of Galilee. The back door of Jerusalem. And only to finally be exalted, not in any kind of regal chariot, but on the hardwood of the cross. This is a God who knows and loves us. This is a God whose love has captured our hearts. And we in turn have no choice
but out of gratitude to return the favor, incarnating that love and grace set loose in the world. So on this day, we wave our palm branches, we think of Palm Sundays in the past, we yell our hosannas, which, in case you're curious, the word literally means help save us. Hosanna. We do all the things that we do, remembering what happened a long time ago. But maybe more importantly, we're recommitting ourselves to the posture of servanthood that Jesus exemplified on a very dusty road at the back door a long time ago. Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Amen.
Amen.
Places where there is conflict. We also pray for our country, a country which we love and in which we live. We also pray, though, for people, specifically people in our own faith family. So this has been a busy week at LCOS in lots of ways.
but recovering from surgery are four: Marcia Bornson, Louise Dassler, John Funk, and Barbara Schmidt. All of them came through well. We pray for those who are hospitalized or still awaiting treatment, for Kathy Funk, sister-in-law of John and Anita, Debbie Glanville, sister-in-law of Debbie Wisman, Christine Price, who was admitted to BB Hospital again last evening, and June Pulliam, Louise Dassler's niece, who's still going through a time of waiting and testing. We also pray for those who are under hospice care. We pray especially this day for Arnold Fish and Art Johns and Kathy Holstrom. Kathy had actually planned to be present today in the first service, but last night suffered a TIA. So hospice care is with her. So for these and others, and we rise. Oh, I'm sorry. We also celebrate milestones. For those birthdays, Mel Ettinger, Pat Campbell White, and Don Level. Anniversaries, Tim and Jennifer Finnegan. And for those who mourn, we're asked again to pray for Judy and Debbie Starr on the anniversary passing of husband and father Roger. And also we pray for the family of Gladys, Shirley Nestor's sister. Gladys died this past week. So for these and others, we rise in prayer. Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We praise you, O God, for the gift of the day, and for allowing us one more chance to celebrate and to remember and to know Palm Sunday. As we think about all that has been before, all that we have experienced, we pray, O God, that you would help us to look beyond all of these things and realize again that this is a call to servanthood. Give us the grace, the encouragement, the wisdom, the discernment, the understanding, and the courage to be the people that you call us to be in the world in which we find ourselves. Help us, O God, in every day to incarnate your gracious love through our words and through our actions so that others might be drawn to your love and to your cross. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
We pray, God, as always, for the world beyond us. We pray especially for places where there is no peace, where there is no celebration of Palm Sunday. We pray especially for the people of the Middle East, Ukraine, Ethiopia, Sudan, Somalia, Niger, Haiti, the list goes on and on. God of grace and mercy, you were the author of peace. You came riding on the donkey to bring peace between your heart and ours. We pray now that you would find a way to bring peace to a very tiny and a broken planet. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray, O God, for the country which we love and in which we live. We pray that you would grace us with the wisdom to listen more than speak, and to seek to understand more than to demand. Give us grace, O Lord, as we seek new ways of learning how to live with each other in a very crowded world. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray, O God, for the church throughout the world, that it might continue and be relentless in its witness to your grace and to your love. Empower, enlighten, and enable us to be the servants you call us to be. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray, O God, for people on our minds and on our hearts. We pray especially this day for
Marcia.
Louise.
John.
Barbara.
Kathy.
Debbie.
Christine.
June.
Arnold.
Art.
Kathy.
And wherever these brothers and sisters are this morning, O God, lift them up, gentle their hearts, calm their spirit. Give them the knowledge and the certainty of your gracious love present for them in this time and season. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray, O God, for those who are mourning. We pray for Debbie. For Judy. And for Shirley. Be with their families, O God, as they mourn this time, as they go through a time of mourning people whom they loved. Give them grace and certainty in the power of the resurrection promise. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We praise you, O God, for those who are being able to celebrate milestones this day. We pray especially for Mel.
Pat.
Don.
Don.
Tim and Jennifer.
Tim and Jennifer.
Be with them, O Lord, as they look back at what has been, but even more, give them grace and courage and humor to look ahead to what yet might be. Help them to know that wherever the road goes, your love is not far behind. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Each one of us, O God, comes into this place with other people on our minds and hearts. We are bold to shout their names out loud now, trusting that you hear and that in your way and time you will answer. And so on this day, we also pray for
Joyce, Faye, Charlie, Rebecca, Jimmy, Shelley.
These are people, O God, who are close to us and dear to us. We pray that in whatever place they are in this morning, that you would find them, that they would know for sure that your love is there, and they know for sure our love is there as well. Bring them healing and peace and strength. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And be with us, O God, as we come to table again, in this time and place to once again receive the gift that you left for us over 20 centuries ago. Bread and wine and body and blood, a mystery beyond all telling. We are bold enough to believe, however, that when we participate in this, that you come to us and you lift us up where we need to be lifted. And you remind us and reassure us again that we are your forgiven and redeemed and ever claimed child. And may this bring us peace and strength and discipleship in your name. Into your hands, O God, we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
And we join together as we say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Please enthusiastically share that peace with each other.
Peace of the Lord. Peace of the Lord. Good morning. Peace of the Lord.
Now I have to ask you to get up again. Sorry. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do as often as you eat it in remembrance of me." In the same way also, he took a cup of the wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave that to them, saying, "Take and drink of this, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood. It is shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." This is the body of Christ that's given for you. Take and eat. And this is the body of Christ that's given for you. Take and eat. Finally, this is the body of Christ given for you. Take and eat. And this is the body of Christ that's given for you. Take and eat. In fact, this is the body of Christ that's given for you. Take and eat. Fred, the body of Christ given for you. Take and eat. Dairy, the body of Christ given for you. Then this is the body of Christ given for you. Take and eat.
Yes.
May indeed the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ evermore strengthen and preserve you in faith, until your life everlasting, departing his peace and for his service. Amen.
Amen.
Oh,
this is the body of Christ given for you.
Thank you.
May indeed the body and blood of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, evermore strengthen and preserve you in faith until your life everlasting. Depart in his peace and for his service. Amen. I invite you to rise if you are able. The word benediction comes from Latin words benedictus, meaning to speak well. So hear this as if God is speaking well to you. May the blessing of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be and abide with you, now and always. Amen.
Amen. Amen.